my bed broke, so I was really glad, but my child wasn't in the van. My goodness. But I'm going to like it. No, no. She kind of laughed it off, like, are you kidding? So I don't know. Well, she was working today, so I don't know.
If it got to that point, there's a way.
No, I don't know what.
There's a way.
I don't know what controls that.
Didn't want to do that.
Maybe she'd have to take a day off. Maybe she's taking a lot of vacation.
I'll make a special.
Go to Canada, exactly.
Because it's really easy to do.
I know she had mentioned she was going to, I know that was going to be Saturday.
She's going to help.
I mean, it's the same thing.
Saturday, yeah, she said, I wrote and said I'll be in. And then when we get together, she said she'll look into it.
Theoretically.
And she wrote me back and said they were all going to help you move on Saturday. So we'll keep it flexible, how she put it. So apparently, I mean, she might have thought it was Saturday.
It sounds like she did. But I mean, I don't really think anybody can help me. Even something simple like opening boxes and putting the books on the shelves. I really want to like have the books in order. See what I need.
Take your time.
Otherwise, it'll just end up chaotic and you're going to have to do it.
The other thing too is that I think you want to. Just in the future, just makes kind of exciting.
I've got this line.
Oh, it's on the wall. It's WAACN 19th almost. It's almost the corner of 19th and Wall.
Says again, the form of things alone. Nose close to the eyes. Otherwise, the most ample figures could not penetrate through such narrow recesses.
You know that part? The borders, yeah. Well, so it's actually slight. And like if you go across the street, you're at the same place. Where they have. It's not open on the weekends, which is weird, but during the week, you can go there and have coffee.
Have some fun tonight. I love his comment about their eyes being such narrow receptacles.
Is that something?
There's some nice little phrase.
Senior food at its worst.
I like that.
Yes.
Some senior centers have some.
Do not proceed narrow receptacles.
That's me. But it's a real cheap year. For a year, it's like $30 or something. It's a small swimming pool in my place, so if you ever wanted to hang out and like just, it's not big enough to swim laps, but it's big enough to like go and cool off and hang around the pool and I don't know.
I thought we would play a little bit with Plotinus and Buddhist. Edmund Spence is perhaps the major thinker in this interesting vein. And he did four volumes. Among them is The Great Liberation, that Book of the Dead, Milarepa, Yoga. But he spends a good deal of time, you see, because the major thinker in this vein is Padmasambhava. And very interesting. He came from what we now call the Swat Valley in Pakistan, the same area in Nagarjuna and the old Tibetan, Greek world emerged from, which is the Gandharva area. In any case, the core of their study is the mind. They have three principles, like Plato has three principles. Now, what's interesting is that three kaya bodies, dharma, truth, sambhoga, nirmanakaya. And what's interesting, which you might enjoy, is getting Evans Vence's The Great Liberation and notice that he quotes Plotinus about 10 times. And when he wants to make a point about the nature of the Trikaya, he quotes Plotinus. When he wants to make a point about the clarity of the Trikaya, he doesn't go into goes into retirement. In any case, it's a very fine piece of work called The Great Liberation. It has about 10 very fine quotes, mostly from Plotinus, and especially the section we're dealing with. Now look, what they do is the highest state of mind, as they see it, the principle of mind, is represented by the Buddha. And that state is called emptiness. Now, to get there, they say there's a body of resource. A resource of that you have to tap in order then to reach a higher state of mind or most profound state of mind or the supreme state of mind. So here on this level they have Manjushri and five major dhyana yoga Buddhas and the Bodhisattvas. And what's interesting is that the state is often shown and discussed as the divine luminosity. The Nirmanakaya is there for all of those people who can have reached enlightenment or the manifestation of it. Now they talk about this, you see, but notice that primarily it comes out of persons, what is entered into Buddha, the person is the state of mind, the Buddha, the mind of the Buddha. And these three, therefore, are the quintessence of understanding the nature of mind. Well, there isn't too much discussion about it, because this is enough to represent the highest supreme state of mind, but the resource for it, manifestation of it. Ivan Spence comes along and he says, you know what, if you want to understand this, he said, let's go to Plotinus, and he has two sources, the three hypostases and intelligible beauty. And it turns out that we were going to read tonight, I understand, something in the very section on Plotinus, the conclusion of Plotinus. And we were on 174 to 190. To just for the moment take a look at the conclusions where we can contrast this, which is on 188, 189. Now, he has one heck of a conclusion at 189 relating to Christianity, which we can ignore. Well, because it's a pretty interesting conclusion. So we're really talking about three paragraphs. And since we're only talking about three paragraphs, I can get myself a cup of coffee, come back, and I know you've read it and understood it. Right, Barbara?
Which three paragraphs?
And
thus much for the doctrine of Plotinus, so delivered by him and the two preceding inestimable books. I shall only add the following observations concerning the Platonic triad of principles, as conceived and illustrated by this extraordinary man, with some reflections concerning the Christian Trinity, with which I shall take my leave of Plotinus. And he does have some reflections on Christianity, but it's kind of, it's at the end and it's kind of fitting, but it's a real interesting analysis. In any case, that leaves us then with only two paragraphs. Hmm. And that's shorter than three by one.
It certainly is.
No, I wanted to show off my arithmetic. According to Plotinus then, okay, take a look. Oh, you've got one of those things. How did you get it in there in the first place?
Marty scanned it.
Did you scan it in?
Yeah.
Oh, good. And zoomed it over?
Uh-huh.
Technology. Mm-hmm. True.
Oh, gosh.
okay, where we're going, you see, is we're going to jump into what is it philosophically? What kinds of terms are appropriate for it? What is the consequent of its being what it is? How known? Its role to cosmology and psychology. So here is his, these are the three principles, and now these are the three principles. So I need help, and since you all have the text, right? Barbara, you're coughing. Could you call on someone for help?
Yes. Oh, is there anyone who wants to jump in?
You mean read?
I don't think so. I think... Okay. Were you looking for a reader, Pierre?
No, I was looking for the baby.
Yeah.
No,
okay. You were looking for an answer, or...
I wasn't paying attention. What were you looking for?
An answer.
Oh, I'm still reading.
Well, wait a minute. If you read, will you stop when you get to an answer?
I continue to do that.
All right. Fair enough?
Fair enough.
All right.
And wait, what's the question she's looking for an answer to?
We got that here. Should be. What is it philosophically, or what terms? What is its consequent? How can it be known? What's its relationship to cosmology or psychology?
And what's the it?
That's why it is so popular. Float around for me. Okay, please.
Still working.
You're still working? Wait a minute. Did she volunteer to read?
I volunteered to read.
She did. And now what's she doing?
Working.
I think there's a hard time.
Mm-hmm. I volunteered to read. I thought you wanted me to answer those questions.
It's
I'll
in
read.
The read.
That's reading.
Oh, okay.
Mark?
Sure. According to Plotinus, then, as the divinely solitary principle of things is perfectly simple, it necessarily follows that he must be perfectly sufficient and perpetually exuberant. Hence, he must be a producing cause. And that which he first produces...
I don't know that word. Perpetually exuberant. I mean, that's a... Sometimes you use the word power.
Oh, really?
Right. But this is an unusual occasion when you use it perpetually exuberant. Right? But the major point is that it is perfectly simple.
That which he first produces must be the most similar of all things to himself. And this is no other than intellect.
Okay, therefore there's a relationship between the two. Thank you. the most similar. Charge.
And this is no other than intellect or the intelligible world, the nature of which has been so divinely explained by this philosopher in the preceding book. Now, this intelligible world, on account of its perfect similitude to the One, contains all multitude in a cult and indistant union. For it is requisite that the multitude should exist occultly before it is scattered abroad and diffused into separate forms, and that it should be concealed in the profound recesses of intellect before it emerges into the diffused splendors of multitude, perfectly divided and discreet. All this, just as the duad is posterior to unity and contains number without being perfect number itself. But as it is necessary that this occult multitude should be perfectly diffused in order to the actual diversity of things and the existence of the sensible world, hence a third procession originates, in which multitude no longer subsists in indivisible union, but proceeds from the sanctuary of intellect into absolute diversity and separation. And this third principle is no other than soul, which expands the impartibility of intellect and unfolds all that was involved in the unity of intellectual perception.
That's it. Now, as we go into what he's doing with the three primal hypostases, this is formless, empty of all categories. First hypothesis.
Okay.
And of course, this is divine luminosity. Thank you. sometimes vitality, depending upon how much you're going to go into it. So therefore, they're quite similar in that respect. Now he's going to give a criticism of the recursive in a Romulus view. He's going to introduce three terms.
Or two.
Three. So the capital S means world soul. When it's a small s, it's individual soul. So now he's going to spend all of this time talking about the way in which these can be further described and their interrelationship between one another. That's where it's going. But first, cut away. And see, the question is going to be, is it possible to talk about this superending soul? And what are you going to put in another term? The demiurgos. Right.
God the Creator.
We have to keep in mind that this idea of God is said to have a paradigm, an idea that he then focuses on so he can then produce the cosmos. Now, here's the problem, you see. You don't need that for this. And that's where he's going in the next paragraph.
You don't need the paradigm for the soul.
Well, this is the called the paradigm.
That is the paradigm.
You don't need a demiurgos or creator. He's using it. That's just an additional. It's not a new principle.
No.
In other words.
No. Yeah.
All right. So therefore, this steps into the region of cosmology, psychology, and theology. That is in this whole interesting structure. Where do you put the God? God or gods? So that goes in here as a class. It's one of the ways you can talk about the gods. It's one of the kinds of things you can talk about in the realm of the intelligence. So there, it doesn't require an additional principle that you can subsume it within.
What do you talk about when you're talking about the world of the soul?
When you're talking about
the world of the soul, you're not talking about God.
The logos?
No, the world of the soul.
The soul.
1, 2, 3.
Well, that's
you're not talking about the gods. Are we talking about this whole mess?
No, no, yeah, okay. This is the third hypothesis.
Okay.
This is the second.
Okay.
And the third hypothesis is often considered world soul.
World soul. Is that a good thing?
And that's where, and now the question is, can you mix that up with a demiurgos, which is one of the gods in the realm of the intelligence?
Yeah, I think so.
That's where he's gone. Remember, all the gods in Greek thought, right, are personifications of principles. And the principles are ideas in the realm of intelligence.
So that's kind of what I was wondering. Would you put the gods down there with the world soul?
No.
In theology, you have to bend it a little, right?
No.
Okay. All right. I'll shut up now.
Well, it also goes back to the time is as well. And we can get into it, because this is a good place to get into it, so let's not delay the difficulties. Now, you have to watch how to read this, because obviously it's making a point that's critical, so. We're doing good with the reader? Still good for it?
Now, besides these, there can be no other principles. For after the cause by which multitude is perfectly evolved, nothing but the gradation and diversities of multitude can exist. Hence, as Plotinus justly observes, we ought not to entertain any other principles, but having established the simple good as first, we should place the supreme intellect as next, and then the universal soul as the third in descent. For this is the proper order according to nature, neither to make more nor less intelligibles than these three. For he who contracts a number of these must of necessity either suppose soul and intellect to be the same, or else intellect and the first good. But that all these three are different from each other, we have often asserted and proved.
Okay, now here comes the difference.
It must here, however, be observed, as Dr. Cudworth justly remarked, that this third hypostasis or principle is not the immediate soul of the world, according to Plotinus and the best of the Platonists, but a supermundane soul. For thus Proclus plainly asserts, not only of Aemilius, but also of Porphyry, who followed Plotinus in this particular. After Aemilius, Porphyry, thinking to agree with Plotinus, calls the supermundane soul the demiurgus of the world, and that intellect to which it is converted not the demiurgus, but the paradigm of the world. Indeed, the supermundane soul must be too nearly allied to that supreme intellect to become the immediate animating principle of the world. And as the gradation of things throughout the universe subsists by the most gentle and easy declension, the descent would be precipitate. Make the highest soul connected with the mundane body. Besides, as multitudes subsist retired and concealed in the supreme intellect, such an intellect cannot be the artificer of the world, since all forms reside there in stable and indivisible union. But a procession and extension of these forms is requisite to the production of the visible universe. And as every cause is superior to its effect, and as the mundane soul must be connate with the world, hence the demiurgus of the world must be superior to the mundane soul.
spite our way through that.
See, it's this diagram, see, it's on this diagram. If this represents, the demiurgos, then the demiurgos is focusing on the realm of the intelligence and using that as a model generating the cosmos. Well, that's basically, right. But is that consistent with, if you're going to call that soul or intellect? He says, go back to the word besides. Besides, as multitude subsists retired and concealed in the supreme intellect. Such an intellect cannot be the artificer of the world, demiurgos, since all forms reside there in stable and indivisible form. But a procession and extension of these forms is requisite to the production of the visible universe. Stay here for a moment. Let me take this off. Say this dude has this experience. Divine luminosity, bathed in divine luminosity, various. What class of statements can he make about what it is he encounters philosophically? I'll tell you one thing. He's going to say nothing more real. That word real is the same as being. The dude is going to say, there is an experience of it. Hey, there is an experience, and I know there is an experience of it. So that means there's something that's encountering that experience. Figuratively speaking, like he's going to call that the eye of the soul. Right? He's going to call it intellect. He says, hey, that stuff that's real, that's, I'm seeing it with the mind, that's what this word means, mind seeing. Therefore, what I'm encountering is intelligence. Oh. Okay, it's good to know, but no difference. Sameness. Right. Continues the same. No boundary. No beginning, middle, or end. Dynamic. Yet it remains exactly where it is. I can use these words to describe this experience. Being, reality, truly, truly, truly is. I can also use the word truth. Being, real, difference, same, dynamic or emotional, rest. I can now talk about it through something. Seeing, as it were, I have a soul, intellect, intelligence. But most of all, man, there's nothing more beautiful. And therefore, it's a bliss. Now, what this dude is going to do is he's going to show this set of ideas, these sets of ideas, entail one another. But from that, you can infer others, so long as they're consistent with it. Therefore, they're in a union, not separated. Right? Since they infer one another, they're in a union, inseparable. Drops down here and he says, hey, you know what? This idea of the demiurge has to look at this and then to create this difference, right? All kinds of differences all over the place, differences. There has to be a further step because these ideas are all linked together. They're all in the union. To create means you can separate them out. It's a different step, a different stage. Therefore, you cannot put the demiurgos in that realm. No. That is to say, the theology will follow the theology of the demiurgos, then follow the cosmology. These two must be connected. And we don't have that yet. To talk about cosmology means now we want to give an explanation of this. This is cosmology. And within it, can you talk about the role of God or the gods? So that's what's in here. You see, that's not it. It's a different ballgame. Now he wants to now go into intelligible beauty, and if so, we're going to get, he's going to focus on this. This is where he's going to focus. When he talks about the three hypostases, he wants to talk about the way these three interrelate. They're on here, the realms. So he's not doing the cosmology because it doesn't fit. But in dealing with the cosmology, you need these three. Since, notice, if this, then this, if this, then this, I'm interrelated. Now, let me give you a puzzle which is, let's rule out this idea of world soul. And only keep individual living things. That makes it a lot easier. So we can just dump this category. This is world soul. We don't need it. Just need individual soul. And if I can get Daniel's approval, we know what's going to be true.
He'll never go for it.
It's like, or put it the other way. By what argument is he going to make room for the idea of world soul?
Isn't that a reflex? It reflects just the higher, it's a shadow of the higher, in the sense that, that it has to, if it's going to be have continuity.
Now look here. How much space is there in the universe?
I think Josh told
me. Come on, how much space is there in the universe?
Well, you mentioned these signs. There's a sign out there that says that's the end, so I was thinking that was the end.
Okay, look. Would you agree, in space, there's a lot of little things?
Comparatively speaking. Relatively speaking, yes, yes.
Yes.
You call them galaxies or not.
Yes.
Right? But it's mostly
space.
Empty space. Agree?
Yes.
And there's nothing in empty space. Therefore, you don't need the idea of world soul, do you? See, I got approval. I got agreement.
I didn't see that as a yes.
She
the head
did.
Was going right
no,
to left.
When she means yes. Did I get it wrong? What do you think? Would you agree? I mean, there's no need to hypothesize flooding the universe with soul. Because all there is just a bunch of stuff in it, but mostly empty.
Yeah.
Okay. I got rid of that.
Not quite.
It's dead.
Not quite.
Well, come on, Jana, work.
How do you know it's empty? How do you know that it's empty when in between all
that? Yeah, because, well, there is little stuff in it, like galaxies. The rest is empty. Take a look at those photographs. Huh.
But they keep finding things in between all of those little things.
Now, would you agree, as you look out, most of it is empty space?
Yes.
Yes or no? Thank you, case closed.
Yeah, but there's always something.
Therefore, you don't need the idea of world soul.
Because if there was a lot of stuff out there, you would need the idea of world soul? Is that the way this is going?
No, you see, it makes it easier.
Just checking.
Even if there's a lot of stuff, it would still mean most of it is empty space, and therefore you don't need the idea of soul. You only need soul when you have things that are alive, and therefore, obviously, you don't need the idea of world soul.
Either that or it's all wasted on one planet.
Well, what?
Either that or it's all wasted on one planet.
There, see?
But, well, there's living things here.
Right, Mark?
Well, because it's not everywhere doesn't mean it doesn't.
Is he using soul for living things in this case? Like it seemed to me from the textbook that he was separating out the occult varieties and using soul to take those occult varieties and perfectly disperse them.
Oh, okay. I find that convincing, don't you? No. Oh.
Well, I didn't see the word life in the first three paragraphs. First paragraph related to soul so much as it was designed as taking that which was occultly the variety that was occultly unified.
Isn't he?
Cold multitude.
Well, it's all kind of the same, you know? Here?
Pardon?
It's all kind of the same. Right? There's perfect sameness, and then there's kind of an integral sameness, and then there's kind of an integrated sameness, and then there's kind of a differentiated sameness.
Doing that, he's going to feed into that, into this structure. He's going to assume the structure, feed into it, and put much more depth into it. And then he has to pull it together in the article on the three hypostases. That's his whole goal. Now, in the end of 6, in the section on intelligible duty, I did need to use his commentary, his paraphrase, which is section 1 from Plotinus, which starts at 174. Okay, now, you know, you got a simple task here. With all of these ideas in the realm of the intelligence, how do you end up with man? All these great ideas? He has to show you how from here you can get here. And to do that, he has to add one more principle. But it isn't a necessary principle in the metaphysics. It's in the natural world. and that is nature. Right. So, to go from here to here, he's going to introduce another term, nature. See, but that's not a primary idea. Primary ideas must, or principles, have to be independent of any creation. So this is creation, this is the creation model.
So we have to step from this triad to a secondary triad.
Yeah.
Yeah.
To go from here, the transition in here is nature. And that's a different, this is a different realm of discourse than this. This is primary, independent creation. Okay, now we're in section on intelligible beauty from section 6 on, or we get into Thomas Taylor's study on 174 on. This is his paraphrase. And in it, he's going to fill us in now. He's going to fill us in on all of this stuff, including here the gods. Remember, the gods are personifications of God. I'm on 181. Yeah, bottom paragraph, you see. You can just jump into a paragraph and you can cut it out and you can put it in there. Intellect itself, therefore, is the first beauty. Hey, it's total. Everywhere, total. Without suffering a defect of beauty in any part. What then is the beautiful itself to be called? Certainly not anything which is not the whole itself. So, as you go further, he's now going to bring in right, the whole discussion of the demiurgos as well and the gods. The realm of the divine objects, and as it's understood in terms of the gods. 184, you jump, you take the paragraphs, you can cut them out and put them in this model. This is where we go, shall we? Mm-hmm. it's just, why don't we just master just two sentences? Isn't that worthwhile?
Yes, any mastery.
Just two sentences. How about the first two on 174? Or should we go for three?
Go for three.
All right. Want to read for us, Marvin?
Sure. Are we reading from Since We Must?
Yeah. Since We Must.
Okay.
Now, watch what we're going to do, right? We're going to see whether we can fit it into the structure. Okay, go ahead.
Since we must confess that the soul which contemplates the intelligible world...
Hey, soul that is going to contemplate this... Go ahead.
...and beholds the beauty of true intellect, may also perceive the Father of this divine world...
Ah, hey.
...who is superior to intellect...
1, 2, 3, right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Right, so we can call this the Father?
Mm-hmm.
It's a generative model. Ah, well, that's pretty good for them. Huh. And it's not even the end of the sentence.
That's it. Let us now endeavor to the utmost of our ability to behold and to express to ourselves, as much as such things can be expressed, how we may in the best manner survey the beauty of intellect and the world which it contains.
Ah, so therefore, looker, when this is encountered as divine luminosity, that's beauty itself.
Mm-hmm.
Right, so he's taking this, what we have here, putting in here. Okay.
Suppose then two stony masses placed near each other, one of which is incomposite and destitute of artificial form, but the other is fashioned by art into some divine or human statue. And if divine, let it be the statue of some grace or a muse. But if human, not that of any particular man, but rather of some one which art has collected together from all beautiful forms. The stone, then, which is disposed by art into the beauty of form, will immediately appear beautiful, but not because it is a stone, or the other mass would be similarly beautiful. It is therefore beautiful because it possesses the form which art supplies.
Applause.
Oh, thank you. I thought I said applause. Mm-hmm. Anyway. Matter, therefore, had not this form, but it existed in the thinking artist before it came into the stone. But it was in the artificer, not on account of his possessing eyes and hands, but because he was endued with art. This beauty, therefore, existed in art in a much more excellent manner. For the form itself, which abides in art, does not proceed into the stone, but this abides in indivisible union, while an inferior form proceeds from this, which neither remains in itself pure, nor is such as the artist wishes, but such as the subject matter is capable of receiving. But if art operates according to what it is, and to what it possesses, but it fashions beautiful forms, according to the reason by which it acts, hence reason is a much greater and truer beauty, since it contains the beauty of art, and is greater and more excellent than everything which proceeds into external form. So far as form proceeding into matter is extended, so far it becomes more debile than that which abides in one. Since whatever suffers distance in itself departs from itself and the integrity of its nature, whether it is strength diffused into some participant, or heat, or power, or beauty extended to some subject, and divided about the fluctuating receptacle of matter. Again, every efficient, according to itself, ought to be more excellent than its effect. For that which is unharmonious does not form a musician, but this is the work of harmony. And that music which is above sense produces the harmony in sensible sound. But if anyone despises the arts because they operate imitating nature, In the first place, it must be confessed that natures also imitate other things. And in the next place, that arts do not simply imitate that which is perceived by the eyes, but recur to those reasons from which the energy of nature consists. Besides this, they produce many things from themselves, and add something where anything is wanting to the perfection of the whole, because they contain beauty in themselves. Lastly, Phidias himself fashioned his Jupiter, his Zeus, not by imitating any spectacle proper to the senses, but conceiving the god such as he would appear if he should be willing to exhibit himself to our eyes.
So this whole discussion rises on the nature of art and beauty, and runs us through this, and it's very beautiful, in order to prepare for the next jump.
Mm.
Actually, he's going to use several of the key points, especially beauty to the artist to grasp reason. Mm-hmm. That's a principle and idea. So now we're going to the next paragraph. A Greek is going to pick that up, he uses that as a basis. Now he's going to build. One more?
Okay. But for the present, let us neglect the arts and consider those beautiful natural effects which art is said to imitate. That is, all rational and irrational animals. But especially whatever amongst these are more exactly finished. I mean where the demiurgus ruling over matter invests it with the form he desires it should participate. What then is beauty in these? For it is not blood and menstrua, but color and figure different from these, or it is nothing. Or something destitute of figure, or it is that which, as it were, contains something simple, like matter. From whence arose the beauty of Helen, for which so great a contest ensued? From whence shines the beauty of other forms similar to Venus, Aphrodite? And from whence did the form of Aphrodite herself arise? Or that of any man entirely beautiful, or of some god, whether they are among the number of things subject to our sight, or among those which are not subject, and yet have in themselves a conspicuous beauty? Is not this everywhere form, descending into that which is produced by the artificer? In the same manner as it was said that the beauty of artificial figures proceeded from the arts. What then? Are works beautiful indeed, and reason existing in matter? But is reason separate from matter, which exists in the soul of the agent, and which is first in dignity and rank? Not beautiful, but is reduced into one with its... I need that sentence again. Are works beautiful indeed, and reason existing in matter? But is reason separate from matter, which exists in the soul of the agent, and which is first in dignity and rank? Not beautiful, but is reduced into one with its subject matter. But if bulk is beautiful, so far as bulk, it follows that active reason, because it is not bulk, is not beautiful. Though if form, whether contained in small or in a large mass, moves and affects in a similar manner the mind of the beholder. Certainly beauty is not to be attributed to the magnitude of bulk. Hence, so long as form is external to soul, we do not perceive and are not moved by its power. But when it is well conceived in the soul, then it affects us with delight. Again, the form of things alone flows through the eyes, otherwise the most ample figures could not penetrate through such narrow receptacles. But magnitude is contracted, not from its being great in bulk, but rather because great in species or form. Besides, it is necessary that the cause itself of a beautiful effect should be either deformed or indifferent, or beautiful. If it is deformed, it cannot produce the contrary to deformity. If it is indifferent, why should it rather produce anything beautiful than deformed? But indeed, it is necessary that nature, the artificer of things so beautiful, should possess a beauty more primary and exalted. But with regard to us, when we behold nothing inward and are entirely ignorant of internal beauty, we follow what is external, unconscious in the meantime that the cause of motion is profoundly latent in the depths of the soul. Just like one who, on perceiving his own image and being ignorant from whence it came, should follow its shadowy and unreal progression. But that there is something else which allures followers to itself, and that beauty does not consist in magnitude, is sufficiently testified by the beauty inherent in disciplines, offices, and the soul, where certainly a more true beauty flourishes, which is then manifest when we contemplate the wisdom in a worthy mind, and are delighted with the contemplation, and in love with its beauty. Not then surveying the corporeal face, which perhaps is not beautiful, but neglecting the whole form of the body, and pursuing inward beauty to its most sacred and profound retreats. But if such a soul does not yet incite you to denominate it beautiful, neither on surveying yourself inwardly will you be delighted with yourself as with something beautiful. Hence, while so affected, you will vainly investigate true and intimate beauty, for you will seek after the purity of beauty, not with something pure, but with that which is base. And hence, too, a discourse on things of this kind is not to be addressed to all men. Because if you behold yourself beautiful, you may obtain a reminiscence of beauty itself.
What is he doing? He started with art, didn't he?
Mm-hmm.
And now this next paragraph is talking all about beauty, isn't it?
Right.
Okay. Now he's going to go to the next step, next paragraph, and he's going to land in the intellect. Right. He's moving up, isn't he? Art in general, how it's made, beauty, and beauty itself, talking about it, the encounters one has with it, whether it's a man or elsewhere. Just for a moment, okay? The reason, therefore, of the beauty contained in nature, so now going to nature, is the exemplar of the beauty appearing in body. But the exemplar of natural beauty is a more beautiful reason contained in soul, from which the beauty of nature flows. But this shines brighter in a worthy soul, already advanced in beauty, than in nature herself, since it adorns such a soul and affords a light derived from one much greater, and which is no other than the first beauty. See where you now see the step into the first beauty. Thus abiding in the soul, it leads it to consider what that superior reason of beauty may be, which is no longer generated nor placed in another, but abides perpetually in itself. Hence it's not reason, but the author of that reason, which is first. Since indeed the first reason has a certain beauty subsisting in soul as in matter, but its author is intellect, which is always the same and not sometimes intellect, because intelligence does not happen extrinsical to this true and original intellect. But what image are we able to receive to such an intellect? For whatever is required after externally is doubtless sought for or in something worse than intellect. An image, therefore, of intellect must be obtained from intellect itself, so that we must not speak of it through the medium of an image. We must receive a certain portion of gold as a representative universal gold. And unless thus received, gold is pure, we must purify it. What's he doing? Moving into the realm of intellect. See, that's where we're going. Soul to intellect. And from here he's going to go. Here.
different than the Buddhist world. They're only talking about personality, personality, the highest, most advanced, enlightened person, the Buddha, the resources, Manjushri, the five dhyana yogas, or the Buddhas, or the Bodhisattvas, and then finally how it manifests. And different. And we're not even finished. We haven't even gotten into it yet. So, we have nothing else to do. Why don't we come back next week and do it?
I have nothing else to do.
I've got nothing else to do. But look here. We want to do this.
Hypostasis.
Right.
Hypostasis?
Hypostasis. The hypostasis.
Marty was asking, what is the meaning of hypostasis?
Yeah, what you stand under. What would you call it? Foundational.
Yeah.
Fundamentally foundational idea.
Fundamental process.
Aren't they like metaphysical levels, kind of?
Yeah, which then would be metaphysical levels. Upon which everything stands.
Yes.
I have a question.
Milestone.
How is Usia similar to hypostasis?
How
is Usia similar to hypostasis? Or is it?
I don't get her question.
She's saying, is Usia similar to hypostasis?
I don't know.
Well, Usia is a process.
Different ideas.
Usia, here.
Why did you bring that up, though?
Because
I don't see it fits, but...
I was working on my own understanding of the word hypostasis, and in relation to Usia, I thought maybe you could help me further understand that. If it is metaphysical principles,
you can put it in here.
Principles.
If you like. A good place would be in here. But you'll see it in the hypostasis because he has to show the relationship between the mind and the intelligence. And one of the ways he does it is to talk about it.
That's what I was asking.
Would it be undignified to define a hypostasis as a strata? To define hypostases as strata? As different?
Strata.
Yeah,
I do. It's strata.
But isn't the difficulty that, in a way, that they become more rarefied, right?
Or full.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Full of reality and right.
Yeah, but like sometimes we look at it this way.
Right.
But actually, metaphysics is this way.
Right. Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah.
But levels are.
I was thinking of the dropping away.
I'm not really sure.
He gets kind of loosey-goosey at the top.
Oh. If nothing else to do but come back and work.
If anybody should happen to meet anybody who's already done this, you might bring them along next week.
Other than Pierre, you're talking.
Well, let's hope there's somebody other than Pierre.
Well, it's fun. It's a fun place to, but See, what's really interesting is where we started out. When Thomas Taylor wants to understand Buddhism, these are the works he quotes, the times. Hypostasis, like intelligible Buddha.
That's what I was wondering. How come the Buddhists always talk about crickets and gongs in the corner and stuff like that, you know, to prove that they've seen purity? You know, I don't get it, you know. They're weird guys. They could be, you know, talking about this kind of stuff.
Yeah, again, back to nature.
Right.
Nature is reflected through the object.
Okay, we got our assignments. We have a little fun. Let's come back and do it.
All right.
That's a good thing.